year at college, I passed as a Harvard student and felt more like an imposter from rural Texas, who still called his abuelita in El Paso every Sunday, who waited for the half-crushed express mailbox of flautas from his mother every few weeks, who took advantage of discovering he was an exotic Chicano in the eyes of Radcliffe women and their visiting girlfriends, to finally get lucky in the Ivy League. Yes, I had arrived shell-shocked in Harvard Square, having never visited the school or the state, without any parents shoving 20s in my pockets or helping me open a bank account, or pointing to where I could wash my clothes. It was startling, too, to be informed I had an accent, something my confident dormmates in Hollis Hall often mentioned, a persona I adopted when I was not satisfied, when I found I was in a prickly situation I had pushed myself into prematurely, even accidentally. That spring semester of sophomore year in 1981, I swelled again with ambition. That was my primordial mistake. At the end of freshman year, I had returned to El Paso as a stock boy to rearrange boys' t-shirts and underwear at the downtown JCPenney. But now as a Harvard sophomore, I set myself and my heights higher than that bargain basement. I would try for a summer job in Washington, D.C., like the other aggressive, uber-confident gov majors in Quincy House. Charles Lane, Mary Ellen Meyer, Jamie Raskin, Nancy Gardner, Colin Leese, you were my heroes. I didn't want to pass as a Harvard student anymore. I wanted to be like these friends and go where they were going. It was D.C. or bust for me. Then I did something rash. I declared to Mrs. So-and-so that I had already committed to summer housing in D.C., that I could not turn back, that I was going to D.C. this summer one way or another. I may even have thrown in a line also about being a voter in El Paso and how Congressman White should be helping all of his constituents in his district. My tone certainly hinted the troublemaker, whether I intended it or not. I was desperate, I tell you. I had nothing to lose. The stubbornness had come from my hard-struggle life in Isleta, El Terco, they always jeered at me. But my bullheadedness had also been refined, sublimated, if you will, at Harvard into sharp words and phrases, and a putting yourself out there semi-confidence with a dash of the comic comedy, too. I noted the Swedish cereal we had for breakfast that first morning, the framed Japanese prints handed down from previous generations, in the maroon Volvo in the driveway. That summer, I would also meet the poet Denise Levertov, Margot's best friend. The incongruities were what confused me. Extremely progressive politics and a toddler-friendly, even messy household, yet unmistakable signs of wealth and power and high culture. Don Stever was an environmental lawyer who worked for the Justice Department with a deep interest in literature and music. That first weekend at the Stevers, they invited me to a barbecue at a neighbor's house. We were surrounded by Washington lawyers and lobbyists and Tony Chevy-Chase, and Don and his bluegrass band entertained the gathering with Grateful Dead songs, Don plucking his bass, his face so concentrated, his musicianship astonishing to me. In my 20-year-old mind, Don and Margot were beings from another planet who were experts at such disparate crafts. As soon as I thought I knew who they were, it would surprise me. Dependent on the agent self making an effort as it is on what others think of you and what others allow you to be. In their eyes, perception you might be trying to change root and branch. For that beleaguered agent self, the point is to never give up. I lied to Don and Margot every day of that summer while I was in the basement of the Cannon House office building. I would clean myself after work every day in a bathroom I found that was often empty. I would smooth out my blazer and tie before I climbed into that Volvo at the Justice Department for the ride home. I would make up stories about what I did in White's office, answering constituent mail and attending hearings for the congressman and writing notes and rewriting policy papers. All of these stories I overheard from my Harvard Radcliffe gov job friends I saw on the weekends at Georgetown parties. To pass who you are, not requires imagination and ambition. To reach what you are not requires guile and grit and even luck. To know what you want, the hearts of this tripartition is a recursive process of trying and passing and obtaining and then thinking about the plateau you have reached. What I learned is that even if you reach the goal you want, the self you want, you still have to interrogate yourself if that goal is the worthy one. If the self you have achieved is what you thought it would be before you achieved it. If it isn't, then you need to give yourself the space and the time to work out who you want to be. You always owe yourself that self-respect. Thank you.